In front of her.
Well, good morning or afternoon. My name's R.G. Head. I have become quite interested in World War I aviation, and I built this model of a German Albatros D-2 airplane, and a little of the background of it. I had built a Fokker D-3, the Red Baron's airplane, the triplane, and it now hangs in the library of Coronado, California. But I wanted to build a museum quality airplane, and that's why I selected this one. And it turns out it was flown by Oswald Bolcke, and this is the exact type of airplane that he flew in the last 3 months of his life, from September through October of 1916. So the Albatros is an example of the middle years of World War I, after they started flying combat in 1915, but before the Fokker D-7s and SE-5s and Fokker triplanes came out, and the Camel came out, that dominated the last 2 years of the war. Some features of the model are the Mercedes engine. They went from a rotary engine to the inline water-cooled engine, 150 horsepower, and in the model itself, which the engine does not run, but there are 486 parts. So I tried to make it just exactly a duplicate of the one made by Mercedes in Stuttgart. The airplane's very streamlined, and the museum asked me if I would leave the left-hand side open. All the kids could see how an airplane was built in this time. And the wing structure is much different than we had expected, because when we build these, usually they're covered with fabric and you don't see inside the wings. But the wings are held together by guy wires that pull the wings, pull all the parts together, and tension struts that pull the, are painted green here, and they keep the wing from collapsing on itself. And you can see all the wires, lift wires and drag wires, and the airplane has some 44 turnbuckles in it, all to a quarter scale. And the cockpit includes all of the instruments that were in World War I, the two machine guns, and all of the controls on the airplane work. They actually have control wires that go out through the lower wing and then up, and you can see it better from the stern, from the left side, if you'll go around, and all the control work from the stick and the rudder.
What is that little gray thing on the top of the wing?
If you come down here a little lower, you can see that the radiator is on the top wing. And those are louvers that allow the amount of air to flow through. And you can see it on the top, and that's a little water container in case there's any small leak in the radiator.
So did he have, did the pilot have a throttle type thing with a, like we would have to do with a butterfly and all that, or did, was it?
He did have, he had full control. Since it's an inline engine, you have full control from idle to full speed, unlike the rotaries, which ran at full speed all the time.
Right.
Very interesting, they had two throttles. They had one on the left-hand cockpit wall and another one on the stick, on the wheel that they held. They had two, one button for each machine gun, and then a throttle lever right on the stick.
Now, this airplane, from what I read in your book about the success of this airplane, the airplanes that they were competing against early in the war, they far outclassed those airplanes.
Yes, they did. They were faster and more maneuverable.
And they had, I mean, I'm looking at the victims were those, the pushers and things like that. Those guys didn't have a chance against this thing.
Yeah.
And the British had, what was it called, the BE-2?
Yeah, BE-2, and then the DH-2 was pretty good. It was still a pusher, but it was better. It was better than the Eindecker, but it was not better than the Albatros. The Albatros was the best airplane of 1916.
And do you suppose they actually did any kind of performance test between that and the triplane?
I don't know.
they ever did or not. It'd be interesting to see what happened.
Yeah. On the engine, you can see the red are the ignition cables, and then they come up to each of the six spark plugs, and the intake manifolds are on the left side of the engine here, and you see they're wrapped with what looks like asbestos tape.
Right.
That is asbestos tape, because at altitude, the fuel being atomized would tend to freeze,
yeah.
And so the mechanics put asbestos tape on there to keep them from getting too cold. And an interesting feature, the valve lifters are actually ballpoint pen springs.
In the model.
In the model.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, let's tell us about Bolcke. Why don't you show your medals here and talk about who this guy was. To me, this is almost the most fascinating part, is who he was.
The Oswald Bolcke was the first of the great pilots of World War I. He was the first pilot to become an ace in the German Air Force, and although they didn't recognize five victories as an ace at that time, when you got six victories, the Germans had the Hohenzollern Award, which is this blue one. And you can see, this Bavarian one, it's over here on the left. The Hohenzollern, of course, is the ruling family of the empire. The emperor was a Hohenzollern, and Germany was unified under the Hohenzollern. So with six victories, you were awarded the Hohenzollern medal. And then 2 months later, he got his eighth victory, and he and Max Emmermann were the first winners of the Blue Max. The actual title is the Pour le Mérite, and it's in French because all of the ruling classes in Frederick the Great's time spoke French, and so that's why the French language is on there.
And the reason they call it the Blue Max is because of...
Maybe because it's a Prussian blue, and maybe for some other incidental reason. We're not actually sure. This is worn around the neck like the Victoria Cross or the Medal of Honor in the United States. This is the Prussian pilot's wings. It's the only set of pilot's wings in World War I that don't actually look like bird's wings. There's a Taube, a German airplane. They're the crown of the empire, and the Taube is flying over the German countryside, and then it's circled in a wreath. The first award the Germans had was the Iron Cross Second Class. And if we were to put that into our terms nowadays, it's probably for about 20 or 30 combat missions. The medal is only worn, this is an actual medal, is only worn on the day of award. And from then on, only the ribbon is worn in the second buttonhole from the top. And so when you see the pictures of Oswald Bolcke or Richthofen or Emmermann, anybody, you'll see this black and white ribbon in the buttonhole.
Did they wear the medals when they flew?
I doubt it. They did fly in full jackets occasionally, but I don't think I've ever seen a picture of them with actual medals.
Right.
In fact, Oswald Bolcke was very shy and never wore his full bar with the medals. There are some pictures of him with the medals that they wore, but generally wore the ribbon for the second class, Iron Cross First Class on the left breast, and then the pilot's wings below that. And that's generally all they wore in their day.
How about the yellow award then?
That is a life-saving award that he got. He was walking in August of 1916. He was walking downtown one day, and a boy fell off a board and fell into the canal. And a French boy, and he dived in and saved him, and he was awarded the Prussian life-saving medal.
I guess he wouldn't accept the French award, I guess. Huh?
Well, the family wanted to put him in for the French Legion of Honor, but the Germans probably wouldn't have that.
And then the Red Award?
These two awards are Turkish. In the summer of 1916, he toured Austria, Bulgaria, Romania, and Turkey, And these were given to him by the Pasha of Turkey. And the red one's interesting. That's the Gallipoli Victory Medal.
Oh, wow.
And of course, to the Turks, Gallipoli was a victory, whereas a defeat for the British.
Right.
And the Australians.
Now, there's the medal you were talking about.
Right. There's the Blue Max. The Hohenzollern Award is the top one, and the lower one is the Iron Cross Second Class. There's the Iron Cross First Class, and then Pilot's Wings. Captain, he died when he was 25 years old, so he's not going to have the raft of medals that generals have after years and years.
Why is he such a significant character?
He, and you used the word character, and that's just exactly right. It's because of his character. It is not only what he did, but it was his character. He was a great leader, he was a great tactician, and he had great empathy for people he was flying with. For example, in January of 1916, he shot down a British airplane, a two-seater. He landed alongside the airplane. The airplanes were slow enough you could do that in those days. He got out, and the pilot had been hit in the arm, and he had been taken off to the hospital. He talked to the observer, whose name was Frantelli, and he said, "Can I do anything for you?" And the observer said, "Yes, I've written this letter to my squadron commander. Can you see that it gets delivered?" Oswald Bolcke took the letter and said, "Sure, I'll take care of that." The next day, Bolcke gets in his airplane, flies over the British airdrome, and drops this letter to the squadron commander in a bag. And then he had the habit of every couple weeks or so, he would have a list made of all the British pilots who had been killed and buried, or were in prison camp or in hospital, and put this list together and have that flown over and dropped on the Royal Flying Corps bases. I mean, that's the most example of chivalry that you can come up with. He shot down another fellow in 1915, took him back to his squadron, fed him coffee and schnapps, and introduced him to all the pilots, and he was a real gentleman. And when this culminates in when Oswald Bolcke was killed in October of 1916, they had a funeral at Cambrai Cathedral in France. And that's an interesting story in itself. The bishop was not pleased. Not only was he the first German to ever have a ceremony in this French cathedral, but he was Lutheran. And the Royal Air Force flew an airplane, sent a lieutenant over in a Marine Sauliner, and they dropped a huge wreath, on the funeral, saying, in commemoration of Captain Bolcke, our valiant opponent. Now, can you imagine that?
They did the same thing for Richthofen, as I recall. They did,
but Bolcke was first.
Yeah.
Now you brought up a very interesting point. Richthofen was a cavalry officer, as you probably know.
Right.
He had his choice. He wanted to fly. And they gave him a choice that you can go to pilot training, which is going to take 3 months, or you go to observer training, which takes 3 weeks. Richthofen was afraid of missing out on the war, so he chose observer training, and he became a backseat observer. Then, after he'd done that for a while, he actually met Oswald Bolcke, and Bolcke said, "Why don't you go to pilot training?" And he did. He graduated in, I think, December of 1915. In the spring of 1916, he was in a squadron, Richthofen was in a squadron on the Eastern Front. Bolcke was told he was going to be squadron commander of the 2nd German squadron, and on his way back from Turkey, he stopped by this squadron on the Eastern Front, where Bolcke's brother was the commander, and he asked Richthofen if he wanted to come with him to the Somme. If Bolcke hadn't met Richthofen on the Eastern Front, nobody ever would have heard of Richthofen. When Richthofen got his first kill on September 17th of 1916, Bolcke had 16. When Bolcke got killed with 40 victories, Richthofen had 5. And then, of course, Richthofen went on for his own very famous career.
He was also a leader in developing tactics for aviation for combat.
Oswald Bolcke was, yes. Just before he left on his tour of the Near East, he sat down with the wing staff and wrote out the first tactics manual, we'll call it, called Bolcke Dicta. There are six simple rules, simple things such as try to surprise your opponent by attacking out of the sun or some other method, follow through with an attack once you begin it, and never turn your back on the opponent, always turn into it. These are simple things that are still taught at Top Gun School.
Okay, now you yourself were an Air Force fighter pilot.
I was.
And the tactics of today, would those three dicta that you just mentioned apply today?
These particular ones probably still apply, but we now have a more modern technology. We would like to shoot missiles at airplanes we can barely see or maybe even out of sight. But if you have to visually identify the other airplane, sometimes we can't use our long-range missiles to the effect that we had hoped.
Which was exactly the problem in Vietnam.
Exactly the problem.
Okay. Now, the other thing is I found interesting in your book is the idea of briefing and debriefing.
Yes. Bolcke was a great leader and a great instructor. And he, not only had he written out these tactics, but the German Air Service reproduced these and sent them to all the fighter squadrons, so the pilots had to learn what the tactics were. And then they talked about the tactics and tried to improve on them. So before every flight, Bolcke would get the pilots together and say, here's where we're going to go, here's what we're going to do. In case of this, you do this. In case of that, we do that. And then he would fly in the air and, of course, monitor what they were doing. And when they get down, he would debrief. And I've found this really interesting. In this country of Germany, which we view as a very hierarchical, strict, disciplined Air Force, he, in his debriefings, he went around and let every pilot talk about what he saw and what he thought were good ideas and what they had learned from. So you have democracy in a very otherwise strict...
Now, early in the war, they went out and willy-nilly, single ship or single airplane. But now, as the war developed, they had more airplanes, so they started flying more in formation. Tell us about the formation they flew.
Well, nobody knew how to assign airplanes when they first started. For example, when the Eindeckers came out, they didn't have very high production. Fokker never had a very high production rate of the Eindeckers, and there were never very many in active service at any one time. So they assigned them two to every squadron. Well, when you have two airplanes, and they really hadn't developed formation tactics, and sometimes one would be broken, you only had one to fly, so they started flying individual airplanes, or they would fly an escort of, say, a reconnaissance airplane and try to help him out. But he and Immelmann actually worked together. When they'd get both airplanes in commission, they'd go out and talk about, you know, and fly together and give each other mutual support. And as we know, formation flying was in its infancy, but they developed methods of having a leader be in front, have the follower be behind. And of course, you double the number of eyes looking for opponents, you double the firepower, and if one person fires out, the second person can roll in. There are many advantages they found having formations, and then they developed the formations larger. And you know, by the end of the war, especially Richthofen's wing, they had huge numbers, 30 or 40 airplanes all
so nowadays,
flying together.
Nowadays, when we see the Thunderbirds fly.
Yes.
Even though we're in a Navy town, when we see the Thunderbirds fly,
we have the Blue Angels too.
They have very, very tight formation.
Yes.
Was that the formation that they used in those days?
You know, formations are a point of probably a lot of confusion. The Thunderbirds flying was called close formation. Every pilot in pilot training learns to fly close formation, and that is 1 to 3 feet between wingtips of the airplane. You don't fly that way at all in combat, except the British before World War II. And the British liked to fly in World War II in trail. formation. Now, trail formation is easy to fly, but there's one big problem. You can have a whole lot of airplanes, and pilots are only looking at the airplane ahead of them, and nobody is looking backwards except maybe the guy in the front. So tail end Charlie can get shot down and nobody even know he's gone. But so trail is one of the worst formations to use in combat. But they learn you can't fly in close formation either, because when you're flying close formation, it takes all of your concentration on the stick and throttle to just stay in formation, as you know. And every wind bobble makes it very, very difficult. So you move out to either a spread formation, which is 200 or 300 feet, or into a root formation, which I've heard that said that the perfect combat formation is within one turn radius of the airplane. So in World War now it's about a mile out. In World War I, it probably would have been 300 or 400 feet, maybe.
At the most.
Yeah. And the other thing they did in World War I that I always found difficult to understand is that they stacked the wingmen up. And we never do that anymore. They said it was an advantage because the following airplane, which is called the wingman or the wing, can accelerate by coming down. Now, that's true, but I think it's dominated by the fact that you want to preserve full maneuverability for the leader. If you're flying on his left wing and he breaks right in a hard turn, you're fine, you're following him. But if he turns left, you immediately blank him out, you can't see him, and you're going to have a tendency to come right in on top of him.
And that happened too?
And that happened. That's the way Oswald Bolcke was killed. Yeah. In a melee and with a flight of his own of probably 5 or 6 airplanes. And 5 or 6 British airplanes.
In October the 28th.
28th, 1916, a little over 100 years ago.
Yeah, oh yeah, right. Well, fighting wing.
Fighting wing is different also in that if you're not going to be two leaders, both offensive, then you drop back, and we use about a 60-degree cone, and the wingman is free to fly any place within that 60-degree cone. We use about 1,000 feet now. They may use a little longer with faster airplanes.
So how fast did the Albatros go?
The Albatros would probably land about 50 miles an hour and had a top speed of 110, which doesn't sound like very much, but it was faster than the opponent's airplanes at that time, faster than the British and French airplanes. Oh. Yeah, you didn't have any brakes.
No
brakes. They shortened the landing run by digging in the tail skid.
It just stops.
Yeah, and there's on this... you can't see it, but there's a metal shoe underneath the tail skid.
And then there's the thing hanging from the wing on the airplane. What is that?
What is that red?
That's the symbol. Red, white, and black, the German symbols and colors in World War I. And those are the indications of a squadron commander. Both the British and the Germans and the French used the symbol. Sometimes they would tie the streamer on the strut, one or both, and sometimes to the trailing edge of the wing.
But didn't that turn out to be a bad idea? I mean, because you shoot that guy down and you got chaos, right?
Well, it depends on how you look at it. Richthofen painted his airplane red, and he said he wanted people to know he was in the air, and he was using the deterrent effect of his own airplane.
Now, what is
it? It's easier to shoot down a frightened pilot than a brave one.
Right. Now, Richthofen was shot down about 30 miles into France, beyond the lines, I should say. Was it Arras? Was that the name of the town?
Could have been Arras.
Yeah, and I think it was about 30 miles beyond the lines to the west.
Mm-hmm.
But the Germans generally didn't like to fly over there. They didn't fly on the other side very much.
When Bolcke was up at the battle, was flying in the Battle of Verdun in the early spring of 1916, they had orders to fly only on the German side of the line. This was for a couple of reasons. One is they believed the defense was stronger than the offense. Secondly, the wind tended to blow them toward the German side anyway. And third, they were flying the Eindecker with the new synchronized machine gun, and they didn't want to fall into the hands of the British or the French. So there were several reasons for it. Bolcke disagreed with that defensive doctrine, and he especially took his forces over the lines, and they started to penetrate deeper into French and British airspace.
Maybe it's worth talking about here is that kind of the essence of military aviation is reconnaissance. And that's how this whole fighter thing started, was the reconnaissance airplanes would basically, German and English and French, would wave at each other early on.
Right.
And then someone threw a brick or fired a pistol or something like that, and then it escalated, so fighters attacked, fighters defended.
Right.
So the German reconnaissance airplanes were generally what?
They were generally two-seat airplanes, but let's go back a little bit.
Okay, good.
Let's remember that in all of the armies of the Western world, the airplane developed out of an army weapon system, and it was designed for observation. So they had, and what you observe is the location of your forces, the location of enemy forces, especially enemy artillery. And artillery is a very dominant arm in all of the armies all over, especially of Europe in World War I. So they viewed the airplane as a visual device, and they would use it for spotting artillery. So it's natural that it would become very closely woven into the ground war, and that's why observation appeared to be the dominant mission at that time. They didn't know very much about bombardment, but toward the middle and later part of the war, bombing became more and more important, an independent mission from observation. And then, as you say, when they learned that you could shoot down the other forces and protect your own, then fighters became into their own. And so the concept, the mission of air superiority developed out of the natural evolution of the technology of the time.
What does air superiority mean?
Air superiority means the ability to fly your airplanes where you want to fly them, at the time you want to fly them, and deny that ability to the other side. So it was vital in World War I, and you have already in World War I ground generals saying that if I don't have air superiority, I can't do anything with my artillery or infantry.
So when Bolcke or von Richthofen were leading 30 and 40 airplanes, what were those missions?
Those missions were probably called a fighter sweep, which is to clear the air in a particular location. And that also is one of the disadvantages of massing that many airplanes, because they only had three or four of those gigantic wings, organization of airplanes, and that meant they could pick where they wanted to fly, but there were a lot of places on the front that were not being defended, that didn't have very many airplanes up.
So how many German pilots were there in World War I?
I don't have any idea. I know that Bolcke's squadron had, and I'll give you a number here in just a minute, about 30 aces in Bolcke's squadron alone. It was the second highest scoring squadron in the German Air Force, only exceeded by Richthofen's squadron.
Oh, really?
Just 11.
So the British really didn't keep track of the number of kills so much as the Germans did. Is that correct?
Well, let's have a three-way comparison. The French had a moderately rigorous method of determining whether a claim was a victory, whether it actually shot somebody down. The Germans had a very rigorous system in that if a pilot claimed he shot an airplane down, the claim had to be verified by an infantry or artillery person on the ground to see the crash. The British did not have very rigorous, they had the least rigorous method of validating claims. Part of this was due to a doctrinal, organizational, cultural philosophy that didn't want to elevate the role of individual pilots. They said it detracts from the fact that all Britons are fighting for king and country. And so they were the slowest to develop the system of aces, and it wasn't until Billy Bishop got so much publicity at home that they really had to recognize some of their most outstanding pilots. Again, the French were, French and the Germans very early on recognized the publicity value of success in the air, and they rewarded their superb pilots most generously.
Was the term ace, which yes. we assume to be more than five, the Germans didn't quite do it. Did they use the same term, ace?
We don't see that term in German terminology in World War I. The French developed it. It was actually developed in a French newspaper who described the activities of one of their pilots at La Asse, and from that came the word ace. Word I'd heard earlier that the Germans used a number of 10 aircraft, but that's belied by the fact that we know they awarded the Hohenzollern Medal with 6 victories and the Blue Max with 8 victories.
But that wasn't a fixed number. It changed a lot, didn't it?
It was a fixed number when it was established, and then later when there were more and more aces, when there were more and more pilots getting the Blue Max, then they increased the number, and I think it eventually got up to about 25 or so.
Oh, really? Wow.
Yeah. It went from 8, I think, to 15, and then 25.
Just the opposite of what we did in World War II with number of flight missions. Started at 30, went down to 25. And
for bombers, anyway.
For bombers,
fighter
yeah.
guys just flew a tour.
One of the things I think is interesting about World War I and the trench warfare is when they realized that the warfare was just nothing but a stalemate. Nothing was going to happen. And they realized Boom Trencher, for instance, and by Balboa or the bombers will always get through. And so let's take out the cities and overfly those lines. And therefore, then the air war changed again to, you know, massive bomber formations of thousands of bombers or 1,000 bombers or whatever. And well, that's a whole other subject.
Yeah.
Can we shift over and talk about the Eindecker?
Sure. Yeah. It's a rotary engine, and the propeller is bolted to the engine. So to make the propeller go around, you have to make the engine go around. So what is stationary? It's the crankshaft. The crankshaft is bolted to the airplane, and the engine goes around. And this one's protected by a cowling, which gives better cooling than if it were let out in just in the open air. But the other one, this was the first warplane because, as you can see, it has one machine gun up on top. And it was the first airplane to develop a synchronized machine gun so that when the propeller is in the way of the machine gun bullet, there's a lever connecting the engine to the cockpit and then up to the trigger of the machine gun, and it prevents the trigger being pulled when the propeller would be in the way. So it's a very ingenious system of coordinating propeller whirl and machine gun fire.
So when was this airplane first flown?
A version of it was flown in 1914 at the beginning of the war as an observation airplane, unarmed, but the first one flew in May of 1915, and that's when Oswald Bolcke began flying the Eindecker, and he got his first victory in July of 1915.
And Eindecker stands for?
One wing.
Now, the
deck being a wing.
Right. Now, the significance of this airplane was against the observation plane.
It was the first armed airplane, and so they got many, many victories without much opposition.
And the nickname for it was? The British called it, and the French.
The period was called the Fokker Scourge.
Right. And so some of the leading aces of the time in the early part of the war were flying this airplane.
They were indeed. Max Immelmann and Oswald Bolcke and several others.
Now, Immelmann died in this airplane, or one of these airplanes.
He did. And we don't know exactly why. Something happened to the propeller. It could have been hit with one of his own shells or perhaps an enemy shell. It got unbalanced and tore the engine apart, tore it off its mounting bolts. Now, let's go on the wing and I'll show you something interesting here. Notice the control cables that go to the leading and trailing edge of the wing. There are no ailerons on this airplane. So how does it roll from side to side? It rolls because the the rear flying wire that comes down to the rear former is pulled tight, and it tends to warp this wing up and warp the other wing down, and so it would tend to turn. However, that is not a very efficient method, and you can tell having to bend the wing is a very hard maneuver, and you cannot do it very quickly. So turning it would have been both difficult and slow, and so it had a very limited maneuverability. In fact, it was said that Max Immelmann invented an Immelmann turn, half of a loop with a roll on top. Some people say it would have been nearly impossible to do the roll on top with this control system.
Yeah, you know, someone told me they thought it was more of a chandelle sort of thing.
That could easily have been, much more likely.
Yeah.
Or a wing over.
Yeah. But the airplane's top speed was?
Probably 80, 90 miles an hour.
But compared to the British and French airplanes at the time?
It was slightly faster and had a big gun.
What was the caliber of the gun?
30 caliber, very small, 0.3 of an inch.
Now the E3, this is Eindecker 3 replica.
1, 2, and 3 were very similar. 1 was the first one, 2 had a little bigger gas tank, and 3 had the 100 horsepower engine instead of an 80 horsepower engine.
It had a 2 or 3 machine guns too, right?
The 4 had 2 or 3 machine guns.
Guns was too much weight for the things, I recall.
And they had trouble synchronizing the third gun.
Yeah. I wonder if anybody does fly one of these.
I don't know. It'd be fun to see.
Now, back at ALSA, they have one of the British pusher airplanes.
Uh-huh.
I can't remember the name. But when I've been there, I usually talk to the pilots. They have 3 guys that fly the airplanes. They want 2,000 hours of commercial license and 300 hours in tail draggers. You'd qualify.
And yeah, I've got almost 1,000 hours in tail draggers.
Well, nobody wanted to fly that stupid pusher airplane. It's so slow. It's like 60 miles an hour, you know.
Right. It's amazing what they started. Oh, can you tell with the new technology, they were trying all different kinds of things. So, you know, in the teens, 20s, and 30s, there are many, many. Didn't take much to be an aircraft manufacturer. And so they were experimenting with lots of different types of machines. And over time, you don't see any more rotary engines. You don't see any more wing warping. They consolidated down and took the best practices of the time.
At the San Diego Air and Space Museum, we have replicas of a couple of airplanes, a whole lot of them. In fact, to promote our own museum, we have, having just been at the Smithsonian, we have a way better World War I exhibit than they do.
I was a docent at the National Air and Space Museum at Dallas.
Oh, really?
Before I moved to San Diego. Yeah, well, this is a great display.
Well, they do have a Fokker D7 though, so mm-hmm. I got to give them that.
Right.
The only one left in the world, I think, isn't it?
Oh, I think there are quite a few. Yeah, we see flying. There certainly are in Australia and New Zealand. They have a lot of airplanes.
How'd that happen?
Part of the British Commonwealth.
Oh, yeah. Well, I thought it was interesting reading in your book about what they did when they turned over the airplanes. I'd heard that they burned them all up, but...
Well, that was after the Allies got hold of them. The Germans certainly didn't burn them up. Well, they may have. We don't know, but I found that to be very interesting.
And go ahead and tell the story of what the German pilots did with them.
The Bolcke squadron, Jasta 2, which was named Jasta Bolcke after his death, was ordered to turn their airplanes over to the British. And the pilots didn't want to do that. They didn't want to give their airplanes away. They couldn't fly them anymore. So in a final act of defiance, each pilot wrote his name and the number of his victories on the side of the airplane. And given that to a British squadron who probably had a lot of new guys, not very much flying time, and not very many aces, if any, they must have been astounded what they were learning, what they were flying against.
Which squadron was Goering in?
Goering was, I don't know what squadron, but he was in Richthofen's wing, and after Richthofen was killed, Goering was not maybe the next one, but the next following wing commander. And by the way, the German pilots didn't like him in those days either.
Did they both
land? Lothar.
Lothar and...
Lothar became very famous. Lothar became an ace. And I'm not familiar with the other.
Lothar died in 22 in a civilian accident, and the other brother became a leader in the art.
In Luftwaffe. Yes, you're exactly
and
right.
And was going to be tried as a war criminal, and died of cancer just before his trial.
Uh-huh, yeah.
So I don't know if he was an ace. Maybe he wasn't even old enough to fly. Uh-huh. What can you tell us about the triplane?
Well, very interesting, and I cover this in the book, which is Oswald Bolcke, Germany's first fighter ace and father of air combat. There were essentially two types of airplanes based upon the type of engine. There were the rotary engine airplanes like the Eindecker, the Fokker D1, the R1, the Camel, and the Nieuports. And they were not as fast as the other airplanes, but they were more maneuverable, very, very maneuverable. The faster airplanes tended to have inline engines, water-cooled, and they were faster, a little more streamlined, but they couldn't maneuver quite as good. So, as with today's airplanes, your tactics depend a little bit on the type of airplane you're flying.
What do you suppose the G capability was of these airplanes?
I've never heard, of course, they didn't have G meters. They knew that when they broke a wing spar that they'd gone too far. They probably pulled 5 or 6 Gs.
I've told people in here that the triplane would probably almost turn inside this room. I mean, I've seen, and the guy that flew it, he said, when you put the power, you can be airborne 100 feet. And he said it's like sitting behind Venetian blinds as they're going up. It just kind of climbs straight up like that.
One of the things that was interesting is that in almost all the air combat in World War I, when an airplane gets hit, it goes into a spin. The British refused to let their pilots practice spin recovery until well into 1917, because they thought it was too dangerous.
Towards the end of the war, World War I, the Germans did start finally using parachutes.
They did indeed. They were the only service, the only military to use parachutes. The British had an opportunity to, but they stopped testing the parachute in the middle of the war, and their pilots were astounded when they would shoot down a German airplane and see the pilot jump out and be rescued by a parachute.
Now, you sort of estimated the kill ratio of Germans versus the, what shall we call them, the Allies.
Mm-hmm.
What was that?
I think it's about 4-1. The Germans shot down about 4 times as many airplanes as did the Allies.
Now the end of the war in 18, when the Americans got involved, were there any American aces besides Rick?
Oh, there are quite a few. There are probably 50, 75, maybe 100. Of course, there were a lot of airplanes. Everybody had more airplanes in 1918, so there were a lot more targets available to shoot at. Plus, there were all the balloons.
Oh, yeah, the balloons. The best of the Allied fighters would have been?
Probably a SPAD 13, which I think we have one here on display. It was rugged. It had two sets of struts on each side of the cockpit. It had not cables, but tight metal rods holding the wings together. It had a very powerful engine, up to 200, 230 horsepower, and two machine guns.
And they
water cooled.
135 mile an hour, something like
probably
that.
Probably about 135.
Mm-hmm. And now, towards the end of the war, the German, like in World War II, the Germans were probably running out of frontline pilots.
Well, they ran out of a lot of things. First of all, all the rotary engines depended upon castor oil for lubrication. And castor oil was a use and lose it. And so it would constantly be thrown out, which was a problem for the pilot, and because he's breathing all these castor oil fumes, and the fact that they would lose oil constantly. So, and the oil is a tropical, or castor oil is a tropical, made from a tropical mixture, and the Germans very quickly ran out of natural castor oil. So they had to develop ersatz, or man-made substitutes, and the engines didn't last near as long with the substitutes than they did with the original castor oil.
And now we call it Mobile One, right?
Right.
So the rotary engines lasted 20 to 30 hours, you
That's
think?
Probably hard to say, maybe between 10 and 30 hours. And it's interesting, I read in one of the books I was doing research in, that when the German Air Service sent airplanes to the frontline squadrons, and the British too, they would send twice as many engines. So they did wear the engines out. All rotary engines were Lerone,
right,
which were French engines, and then the Germans developed a version of it, the English probably developed a version of it. Albatros joined JASTA II after Bolcke had been the squadron commander, after he'd been killed, and then you're right, he later was transferred to Richthofen's squadron.
But the two of them, look at a picture on the wall of Bolcke.
Yeah.
And, you know, they're both honoring Bolcke in this. It was a very short scene in the movie. Mm-hmm. The first time I saw it, I didn't even notice it or think about it. So.
By the way, there's an interesting feature about Werner Voss was Jewish. And it is not well known, but there were several Jewish pilots in the German Air Force. One of them had a cross of David on the side of his fuselage.
I mean the Star of David.
Star of David.
Really?
Yes.
Werner Voss was Jewish. Huh?
It was not a big factor. Not a factor.
It shouldn't be.
It's
so stupid,
right,
to me. I don't get it. Let's go to modern date.
Okay.
All right. Now you've been out since 87, so you're not probably completely up to date on what's going on.
No, I try to read the newspapers and keep in touch, but you're right.
So we have air superiority fighters. I suppose the F-16 would be considered an air superiority
fighter.
Yes,
the primary one's the F-15, of course.
Okay.
And now the F-22.
And the other one is the F-35. And
just coming online, yes.
Right, yeah. Woe to the guy that loses the first F-35.
Bound to happen.
It's going to happen sooner or later. So now the airplanes that you flew F-100. We were just talking.
F-100s, A-1s, and F-4s.
And which 100? Which one? The F model or?
The F-4?
No, the
F-100?
Yeah.
D model. C's and D's. The C is an interesting airplane. That's the one we flew at Luke and going through fighter training. 180 knots on final approach. No flaps.
Wow.
180 plus fuel, in fact. Two knots for every 1,000 pounds of fuel.
So
F-100A model also had another feature in that the tail was too small, the vertical tail. So it would get into a spin and it couldn't get out. And they lost a couple of airplanes that way. So they enlarged the tail surface, and all the subsequent airplanes had the larger tail.
Talked enough, you think, or?
I think that's enough.
Okay.